This is Duke University Chapel.
Well, good evening, everybody. If you have a cell phone, there's never been a better time to switch it off. And if you haven't yet taken your seat, now would be a great time to do so. It's my very great pleasure to welcome you to Duke Chapel this evening. One of the many privileges of my role as Dean of Duke Chapel is to meet and get to know some of the people advocating for and embodying some of the most notable social and theological currents of our time. And tonight is one of those nights. The mission of Duke Chapel is to keep the heart of the university listening to the heart of God. And tonight we have a wonderful opportunity to reflect on issues close to the hearts of a great many people at this university. The format tonight is that the three of us will talk together for three quarters of an hour or so, and we'll simply forget that you're here. And then we'll invite questions from the floor at the three microphones that you can see around here. And that'll go on for a similar length of time. So we'll be about an hour and a half for the whole evening. Bishop Robertson, I'm very glad indeed that you're here. Janie Long is now going to offer a more formal welcome.
Good evening. The Right Reverend Eugene Robinson was born in Kentucky, the son of tobacco sharecroppers. His family was poor. They used an outhouse and they did laundry in a cast iron tub over an open flame. When he was born, he was so seriously ill that the doctor was certain that he would not survive. His life is a compelling story of challenges overcome again and again through deep faith, courage, humor, and love. Bishop Robinson was elected Bishop of the Episcopal Diocese of New Hampshire on June the 7th, 2003, consecrated a bishop on All Saints Sunday, November the 2nd, 2003, and invested as the ninth bishop of New Hampshire on March the 7th, 2004. His ministry to the church has focused on clergy and congregational wellness, coordinating program among the seven dioceses of New England, youth and college ministry, and conflict resolution. Do you ever have chance to use that these days,
nope.
Bishop? No. Bishop Robinson's election and consecration has been at the center of worldwide Anglican Communion's debate over the full inclusion of LGBT people in the life and ministry of the church. His personal story is featured in the 2007 feature-length documentary, For the Bible Tells Me So, which you may not know, but was written and directed by Daniel Carslake, who is a Duke alum. The bishop holds a BA from the University of the South, an MDiv from the General Theological Seminary in New York, and several honorary Doctor of Divinity degrees. He has been a strong advocate for social justice on many levels, including he's helped to develop curriculum for AIDS education, he has led anti-racism training, and he's reached out to encourage support for impoverished nations all over the world. Numerous human rights groups have recognized the bishop, and he's been the recipient of both the 2004 Gay and Lesbian Task Force Leadership Award and the 2008 Elizabeth Birch Award of the Human Rights Campaign. Bishop Robinson is the father, I would say, very proud father, of two daughters, and also the very, very proud grandfather of two granddaughters. He lives with his partner, Mark Andrew, who is employed by the state of New Hampshire. Welcome, Bishop Robinson.
Thank you.
Bishop Robinson, you've written about and talked about being swept to the center by God. Can you tell us what you think has really been going on? There's been lots said in the media, there's been lots discussed on blog sites, but what's it really all about? What's it been really all about for you, and perhaps what's it been really all about for God?
This really has been a storm of sorts. At the General Convention, when the clergy and laity and bishops of the church were asked whether or not to consent to my election, after the clergy and laity had consented, there were charges brought against me for sexual misconduct and being linked to a pornographic website. I knew that both of those things were not true, but what we didn't know was whether we could prove that before the end of the convention. And oddly enough, I had actually helped set up the procedures for such investigations as part of my national church work, and actually was quite proud. I think it was a great day for the Episcopal Church because we knew exactly what to do. While I was sequestered away in my hotel room with my partner and our younger daughter, Ella, someone brought me a piece of calligraphy. This fellow is now my assistant. And it said, "Sometimes God calms the storm, and sometimes God lets the storm rage and calms his child." Almost the same moment, I got emailed to me, another priest in my diocese, a photograph of a hurricane taken from outer space. It's a photograph of the Atlantic with this enormous, hundreds of miles wide, swirl of white. And in the center is this little pinpoint of blue. And so that's the center towards which I feel that I've been brought to. I don't think any of us can stay there on our own. I don't think it's possible to not get caught up in the raging storm without help from God. And so in many senses, the kind of calm that I feel is God's doing. There were death threats before my consecration, and I actually took an hour's nap just before I went over for the service. And I got up from my nap and strapped on my bulletproof vest, and my partner strapped on his bulletproof vest, and we went over for the service, not knowing what would happen. So you have to wonder, you know, what is happening to cause that kind of outrage? At first look, it appears to be about homosexuality. You step back a little bit, it seems to be about biblical authority, although I think that's a bit of a misnomer, because often the debate is put in, you know, we have people who play fast and loose with Scripture and people who just plainly read it and believe what it says. And none of us plainly read it and do what it says. We all interpret. So this is really not about the authority of Scripture. I think every religious tradition takes its sacred text seriously. The question is, how do we understand it? How do we put that together with the context in which it was written and so on? So if you step back one step further, And you notice that this has way more power and energy than it ought to. I mean, you know? I mean, and in any congregation or in any situation, when something has more power than it ought to, you know something else is going on. And of course, the trick is figuring out what that is. My own opinion about that is that this is actually about the beginning of the end of patriarchy. For a very, very long time, straight, white, educated, middle to upper class men, Western men, have made most of the decisions for the world. And that jig is up. And you know, I think that we saw, certainly in this country, with the civil rights movement of the 1960s, the at least the beginning of the welcoming of people of color to the table. In the 70s, the welcoming of women to the table. I think now we see the LGBT community being welcomed to the table. God only knows who's next. And that just won't ever satisfy us ever again, the way it actually didn't satisfy some of us all along. But we just won't stand for that. And I think there's a sense in which we know we need all the voices at the table. And so if it's about the end of patriarchy, at least the beginning of the end of patriarchy, then it's no wonder that the resistance is so great and that the debate is at such a fever pitch, because you know, it's been around for a long time. And people will ask me, like, when is this all going to be over? Like, when are we going to not be in turmoil? My sense is that it won't be over until there's no more them and us. It's just all us. It seems to me that what God wants us to do is to, you know, we all have that little line around us that separates us from them. And God wants us to keep pushing that line further and further out until there's nobody not included in it. So I think that's what's happening. And it's a pretty exciting thing to see. But it's going to be tough going for a while, whether on the issue of the inclusion of gay and lesbian people, race, gender, we're not nearly where we need to be on any of those things, and the links between all of those isms, I think, are critically important for us to see the ways in which they work together. You know, the oppressor, who, however defined, tries to get all of the oppressed to fight with each other. That way, we don't all, because if we all got together, we would be the majority, by a long shot. But if those who would want to keep the status quo the way it is keep us fighting with each other over whose pain is greatest, then we won't actually focus on the source of the problem. So I think it's a really exciting time to be alive.
You make the links in the book several times, and you just made the link between how religious communities have treated LGBT people with how they've treated people of color and with how they've treated women. There are some in those communities who would counter that being LGBT is a choice and therefore inherently different from the groups that you have linked them with. I wonder if you could speak to that for a moment.
Well, What I've tried to say is that I think some of the dynamics that went on around the fights for equality around race and gender are similar to the dynamics that go on with respect to the LGBT community. And in that sense, I think you will find me very seldom using the word homophobia, for instance. I don't think it's a helpful word. There are a few people who actually are fearful of homosexuals, mostly I think it's more homo hatred than homophobia, but more than that, you will hear me talking about heterosexism. And the, I mean, I think we all know what an ism is. It's when you put prejudice together with power to enforce the prejudice. So racism, people of color can be prejudiced like crazy, but it's white people in this culture who have not only the prejudice, but the power to enforce that prejudice that makes it racism, that makes systemically it's set up to benefit people of European descent. Similarly, with gender, women can be prejudiced, but it's typically men who have the power to put in place laws and traditions and patterns of being that enforce the prejudice against women and that benefit men. So I think what we're really dealing with is heterosexism. And I think that word puts the onus where it belongs, which is that the culture heretofore, I do believe it's changing, has been set up to benefit heterosexual people at the expense of homosexual people. In huge ways and in small ways, I'll give you a small way. I was just reminded, I had a sabbatical last fall, which is the only way I could have time to write a book. And my partner Mark and I were coming back from New Zealand. And as always happens, when we come back into the country, the flight attendant comes down the aisle and says, with the customs and immigration forms, and you know what she says? Or he? One per family. Oh, I'm so sorry, you need two. It's just one of those little ways in which the system is set up to communicate to me and my partner that our family doesn't count. It's not as good as a heterosexual family. So I think the ism that we're dealing with here is properly called heterosexism. I would never want to make too close a connection between what African Americans have experienced in this country, what women have experienced. What I always try to say is that my experience of being a gay man gives me the tiniest little window into understanding what it must be like to be black or Asian or Hispanic, to be a woman, to be in a wheelchair, to be discriminated against for any other way. So I count it as a great gift to have had this experience because it at least gives me some way of understanding that. Around the choice thing, I think I would say to people in the African American community or to women, we've tried very, very hard to listen to your experience. And I would just ask you to listen to our experience, and our experience as this is not anything we have chosen. It's interesting, even the ex-gay ministries, so-called, have stopped claiming that they can change a person's sexual orientation. That used to be their claim. Mm-hmm. Even they are now admitting that they can't do that. What they can do is sort of give you a long and drawn out pep talk. They can cheerlead you into kind of white knuckling it enough so that you don't ever act on it. And if that's the way you want to live your life, then you can choose that. But even they don't even claim to change your sexual orientation. The best science at the moment says that orientation is probably determined by age 2 or 3, and it's probably some as yet not understood combination of nature and nurture. We just simply don't know. Although the lesbian comic, Kate Clinton, says, pointing to me, "We finally found the gay gene."
Very nice.
I take that as a real badge of courage. And the obvious thing, of course, is why would anybody choose this? Why would anybody choose this grief to go through? I think that's only common sense.
I wonder if we could stay with questions of identity for a lot of people, and maybe for a good number of people here, to be a priest is the heart of their identity. Could you tell us whether that's the case for you, and if so, or if anything like it, what actually does it mean to be a priest?
I think we're all called to be priests. That is to say, the priesthood of all believers, that our baptism calls us to ministry in God's name. And then the church sets aside particular people to do particular things for the community primarily. I actually like to think of the real ministry of the church is that of all the baptized. And then some people pull back to a smaller realm, which is to minister to the real ministers, the laity. And then some of us are actually chosen to pull back even further to be ministers to the minister to the ministers. So rather than a pyramid going up like this, I actually think it's a pyramid going like that. It is a real part of my identity. I was trying to think of some images to use about that. I think Moses is, although he was not of the priestly class, I think what Moses does in the Exodus is very akin to priesthood, which is that he lays out a vision of God in a very compelling way that is so compelling that people actually want to leave what they know. I mean, you know, slavery wasn't all that great, but at least you knew where you stood, you knew what was going to happen next, and once they left Egypt, they didn't know what was going to happen next. So first is someone who lays out a vision of God that comes out of their own experience. I don't think he could have done it had he not had the burning bush experience, you know, a real solid experience of God himself, because without it, his vision would not have seemed so genuine and authentic and compelling. So a priest's formation is so important, and his or her own relationship to God. Laying out the vision, then there's a cheerleading aspect of the priesthood, which is, okay, we've got the vision, forward, out of Egypt, follow me. And then there's the getting to the River Jordan, not the River Jordan, the Red Sea, and feeling as if there were no options left. And it seems to me that what Moses did and what priests do is to say, okay, there's more here that we can't see. What we need to do is to trust God in this difficult and seemingly answerless situation. And then they get across the Red Sea, and the Promised Land is not waiting for them. The desert is waiting for them. 40 years of the desert. And so then it seems to me that the job of the priest, as Moses did so well, was to then interpret as best he could to the people why they were there, which I think was to learn their dependence on God and to encourage them when they wanted to turn back. Earlier today, I was saying, you know, they just got sick and tired of that manna every morning. First of all, it was the same thing day in, day out. It tasted like wet, soggy cardboard. I mean, who wants this? And they got to dreaming about all the good food they left back in Egypt. Okay, so it was, you know, you had to be a slave in order to get it, but at least the food was good, right? And so it seems to me that a priest journeys with his or her people in a way that is meaning-making. How might we think about this? And it seems to me that the priest is the one who is always asking, where might we find God in the middle of this? And then the pathos in that story for me is Moses leads them right up to the promised land, but has to let them go. He actually doesn't make it. And so it seems that in the end, the role of the priest is to empower people to come closer to that God and set them free, because really only they can get there by God's grace. So that's a lot of what priesthood is made. The other thing that I've come to think is that priests are Rorschach. That we are living, breathing Rorschachs onto which people project the most horrific and most wonderful things. And neither of them are true. Well, sometimes they're true. I think that's an appropriate role for any holy person, shaman, rabbi, priest, whatever, to take. And I think it's an appropriate use of us by God. That is to say, the community has set us aside as, in some sense, to be that Rorschach, so that God can use us in ways that we don't even always comprehend. I think when you experience it the most, and those of you who have played this role, you know this, you go into the hospital room of someone who's dying, or you're sitting with the family of someone who's dying, or it may be in premarital counseling or any number of pastoral situations, and you get the sense that you there's more than just the three of you in the room or whatever, that somehow you, rightly or wrongly, helpfully or unhelpfully, you represent God in that situation. And why I think our formation and why the keeping of boundaries is so important for ordained people is that in order for that not to get out of hand, for us to lose track that we are not God, we are only representing God for people, and that God is using us briefly for a greater good. So if we keep those boundaries straight, then God can actually use us to do things that need to be done. Because at a time of death or some kind of crisis or whatever, people need and want to hear from God. They want to know if God still loves them. They want to know if something is there beyond death. And the preservation of those kinds of boundaries are just so important for us to be able to do that and not lose track that we're not God, but we have offered ourselves to be used by God in those situations. It's a little why, you know, for those of you who are not in seminary, you might be interested to know that we have this great debate in seminaries since time immemorial about, can you be friends with your parishioners, right? You know that debate? Part of the issue there is, so if you're such a close friend to one of your parishioners, when your friend needs God's representative there, have you robbed yourself and God of the opportunity to use you because this person can no longer see you in that role. I mean, that's the one side of that issue. And I would say it has to do with it being a willing Rorschach.
So being a priest is obviously at the core of who you are. And the media and others sometimes portray you as rather one-dimensional.
Which dimension would that be?
That you're not...
A good-looking, hunky guy. I confess.
I did... Remember, I did say he's used his humor. Well, you're not the bishop who happens to be gay. You're the gay bishop.
And I love the way that rolls around in here. It's
just... you know, I talk to a lot of students on this campus. A lot of LGBT students. And the greatest fear of those students is that if they stand up and say, this is who I am, that becomes the sum total of who they are to everyone. Doesn't matter their intellect, doesn't matter their athletic abilities, doesn't matter their service, their place in their faith communities, that's all they become. And I wonder if you might have a word to speak to them tonight.
It's a great question. I think probably the first thing to say is a lot of what you say or what they might worry about is true. So let's start there. I'm not sure that it's any different from other times when maybe being an abolitionist or being a suffragette or taking on some other kind of identity didn't get you labeled and you paid a price. Why is it, do you think, that Christians are surprised when doing the right thing costs us something? Wouldn't you think that Christians, maybe Jews as well, would know that following in God's ways almost always gets us in trouble? And that we almost always will pay a price for living a life of integrity and so on. The nice thing about that is that the other part of the Christian message is that we never have to be alone in that. No less than God, God's own self, promises to be with us in it and promises to reveal God's self to us in the midst of that process. It seems to me that the great reward of doing the right thing, whatever the right thing happens to be at the moment, is that it brings us closer to the nearer presence of God. When you hang out with people who are standing up for the right things and paying a price for it, you know you have been close to whatever is at the center of the universe. And if we claim to be Christ followers, for those of us that do, have we forgotten how often Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me? If you want to save your life, you must lose it. I mean, there are all of those sort of divine reversal things that go on that say living this kind of life of integrity close to God is going to cost us something. The big news, of course, is that on the other side of Maundy Thursday and Good Friday is Easter. And that is not only our hope, but I think for many or most of us, it's our experience. It's just that we almost immediately get fearful again and forget that that's the only way you get to Easter is through a Good Friday. So, around the gay issue, yeah, you know, I was naive early on. I often said, I want to be a good bishop, not the gay bishop. Well, in the last 5 years, I have kind of made my peace with realizing that being the gay bishop, as much as I wish it were a non-issue, is an issue right now. And this just appears to be something that God has called me to for reasons I cannot imagine. Mercifully, I have a diocese in which I am not the gay bishop. I'm just the bishop. Oh my God, here comes the bishop. You know that. And so 90% of my time I spend doing what bishops do and loving it. And the other 10% of my time I am in places as the gay bishop. So, I figure if that's what God needs right now, if that's what God wants right now, then, as in Isaiah, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? I guess, I guess it'll be me. And I would lay that on you. You know, there are many, many pieces to this puzzle of change that we're going through. The reason we are where we are right now in the culture and in the church, and every denomination is dealing with the issue of homosexuality, even those who are absolutely clear where they stand on it, right? Does anybody think that homosexuality is not an issue in the Southern Baptist Convention or the Roman Catholic Church or whatever? So if that's what's going on, the reason it's going on is that so many of us have come out. And so what has happened in family after family and group after group is, you know, this is the way change happens. You have a worldview that works pretty well. It pretty much describes the way the world works. And then you have an experience that doesn't fit, that for which that worldview is insufficient to explain. And then you're thrown into chaos, and then generally speaking, you either go back to this old worldview and deny or reject that experience, or you come out with a new worldview that takes that new experience into account and explains it as well. And I think that's exactly what happens in a family when a kid comes out as LGBT, and so this experience does not fit what they thought about that kid and the love that they have for that kid and so on, and they're thrown into kind of turmoil, and then most of them come out on the other side with a broadened and deepened love that includes that child. The reason we're in this, where we are in the culture and in the church, is that so many of us have come out that no one is left, pretty much, who doesn't know some family member, co-worker, neighbor, former classmate who is gay or lesbian. And now when we talk about this issue, a face comes up, or two faces come up. And the things I used to be willing to say about homosexuals, I'm not willing to say anymore because I know Sally and Joe, and they're not like that. So for those who would, you know, not like to be labeled just this one thing, I guess I would just say two or three things. One is maybe it wouldn't be as bad as you think. You'd be surprised if you did that to learn who your real friends are. You might have a ministry to a bunch of people who would have trouble with your coming out as gay or lesbian at first, but they might be one of those people whose hearts are changed because you're now the person who comes up when they hear it. So I guess I would invite you to at least think about the possibility that this would be an opportunity for ministry. And so if you have to pay a price, well, hello, welcome. You know, one of the things that I've studied quite a lot is the civil rights movement of the 60s. And the thing that I so admire about the African-American community is that they did what they did knowing they would pay a price. They knew there would be dogs and fire hoses and death. And they did it anyway. And some of them paid for it with their lives. And in some ways, and I have often said this to LGBT groups, is, you know, we need to toughen up. We cannot expect to do this without paying a price. Let's learn from our African American brothers and sisters and be willing to do this hard thing because there are kids out there in grade schools and high schools that will either be better off or worse off because of what you and I do around this issue. And we have to be in this for the long haul. And we may be the ones who have to live through this getting labeled and paying a price, but you know what? What a magnificent contribution for us to make. And the last thing I would say is, and if you don't feel like you can do it now, that's fine. Just keep it in your heart. Take it to God. Talk to your trusted friends about it. And see if at some point in the future, this isn't the contribution you want to make. We're all different. We all have different family settings. We all have different work settings. And we all can't be out there. And that's a very personal decision to make. But it might not be as bad as you think, and it might be more wonderful than you can imagine.
You've used a fascinating phrase, close to whatever it is that's at the heart of the universe. I wonder if you could tell us about the figure that Christians traditionally think of as being at the heart of the universe. And perhaps put it this way, was there something wrong with the universe or wrong with the world that Jesus came to put right? Or did Jesus come out of God's overflowing love as a kind of surplus?
I like that idea.
If Jesus came to put something right, did it work?
How much time do we have?
Usually, people answering this question write a three-volume...
Yeah, that's what I know that. That's what I mean.
Traditionally, they die somewhere in the course of writing the third volume.
Exactly.
Give us yeah. That executive summary that
okay.
comes at the front.
Okay, executive summary. The reason I use so many words when I substitute something for God is I think God is so much more than any box or any word that we use to put God in. And I think there were probably several reasons for Jesus coming. I do believe that Jesus is the perfect revelation of God, which is not to say that Jesus is the only revelation of God. God would not be worth much if God was limited in how God revealed God's self to us. But I do believe Jesus was the perfect revelation. I think that Jesus came to save us, but I might mean something different by that than some others would mean by that. I think Jesus came to save me from myself, because I am my own worst enemy. I think God became incarnate in Jesus to prove once and for all that God's love for me is absolutely, unimaginably wholehearted and inexhaustible and unassailable. That no matter what I do, that will be there. Another reason I think God came, I have a good friend who is an Orthodox rabbi, and you know, you got to love the Jews. They love to play with Scripture. We tend to put the Bible up on a pedestal and almost worship it. And the Jews will have none of that. They, you know, if you've ever been to a Seder, they're arguing over, you know, why did God do the plagues and what was he thinking and blah, you know, all that. So this Orthodox rabbi pointed out to me, he was trying to make the point that we get to decide what makes us happy and around sexual orientation. He pointed out that in the story, in the second creation story, there are two, by the way, those of you think there are only one. In the second creation story, the first fly in the ointment in Eden is Adam is unhappy. He's lonely. And this is the astounding thing he pointed out to me that it never occurred to me. God doesn't know why. God actually doesn't know why. And in an attempt to make Adam not lonely anymore, God brings a host of animals. It's in there. I swear I did not make this up. So, you know, this rabbi friend of mine says, you know, well, you can imagine Adam sitting there and God brings an armadillo. God brings, you know, a water buffalo. It's like, no, really. Not the duck-billed platypus, no, thanks, no. And then God says, I know, and makes Eve. In some odd sense, I will probably be skewered by every theological journal in the history of the world when I say this. Could it be, I'll just ask it as a question, could it be? Could it be that God became incarnate in Jesus to find out what it was like to be us from the inside out? What I know is that it matters a lot to me that Jesus was a man. I don't mean the male gender, that was a human being. Because if he wasn't, then he was just pretending to be human. And if he was just pretending to be human, then he doesn't know what my life is like. If he really wasn't sweating blood in the Garden of Gethsemane, if he didn't really, you know, if he thought, oh, you know, okay, so this is going to be hard for a couple of days, but, you know, hey, Sunday's coming, you know, don't look forward to being nailed upon a cross, but hey, you know, for generations to come, they're going to be having Easter Sunday in my honor. No, I actually think that God made this remarkable decision to limit God's self down to our existence and that Jesus walked around knowing just pretty much what you and I know, which is not much. I mean, does any of us know what's going to happen an hour from now or a day from now or a month from now? And I take great comfort in knowing that the Jesus I pray to actually knows what it's like to be me from the inside out. So when I'm anxious and worried and fearful and all of that, I think we are praying to someone who knows exactly what that's like. Now, you know, I get all the theological stuff about, you know, God is omniscient and all that kind of stuff, but it seems to me that the thing that God is most omni, you know, in addition to omniscient and omni everything, is omnivulnerable. Seems to me God was vulnerable at creation. Is there anything more vulnerable than creating something and not knowing whether it's going to love you back? And giving us the free will to love God back or not? God made God's self vulnerable all through the Hebrew Scriptures, trying to get through to us, and then finally, almost in an act of desperation, God says, you know, okay, I don't know what else to do. But to become incarnate. And that's the ultimate vulnerability. To give up being God to become one of us. And then, of course, God, in fact, does do this dramatic thing on Easter morning, scribbling God's signature across that life to say, okay, now, you want to know what I'm like? Look at this man. You want to know how much I love you? Look at this man. You want to know whether you'll be welcome when you come home to me? Listen to the story he tells about the prodigal son. Oh, yeah, and by the way, both sons were welcome. It seems to me that if it's not irreverent to say that God, in order to really get through to us, needed to become one of us. And I'm of a mind that God is, I don't know, is it irreverent to say that God is learning along with us? I think there's a debate right now in theological circles. I don't have much time to keep up with them, but it's about, does God know the future? Because if we are free, in fact, to choose, and make decisions on our own, really free, then maybe God doesn't know what's going to happen either. That you can get into some shaky territory there, but here's what I know about that, is that there is something very, very dynamic about God's interaction with the world. And it's one of the reasons that biblical literalists give me nightmares. Because I get the impression that in their minds, God stopped revealing God's self at the end of the first century when we closed the canon of Scripture. And the God that I know is interactive in my life all the time and wants to be in yours, and if you're letting God, is active in yours as well. And so I love playing with these notions of a God that is mixing it up with us and doing everything God knows to do to let us know of his love for us and wanting a relationship with us. You know, you don't have to scratch this Episcopalian surface very deep to find the Disciples of Christ evangelical lurking right underneath. And I'll just finish this by saying, and I think God, in becoming incarnate in Jesus and living and dying and rising again for us, accomplished something for us that we could not accomplish on our own. I'm at a loss for words to really describe that in any terribly helpful way. I just believe it's true.
as the visibility of the LGBT community here on the Duke campus has increased, so has hate speech, and so have hate crimes. And one of the things that has become very apparent to me is that in addition to people who are LGBT standing up, that we have to have our allies. And my guess is, looking out at our attendees, that there just might be a few allies in attendance tonight. And my guess is that they are standing up in communities of faith in the face of a lot of really adamant opposition. And I wonder if you could give them a word.
Hmm. Well, two words come to mind. Thank you. You cannot, yeah. You cannot imagine what it means to those of us who are gay or lesbian, bisexual, or transgendered to have someone who does not have the kind of stake in it that we do stand up for us. There are other people here who have been discriminated against and treated poorly who could tell you stories about people who stood up for them and what it meant. Greater love has no person than to give up his or her life or part of a life or part of a reputation or whatever for another. It's a really powerful ministry that you have. And let me just say that there are those of us that you know about, but there are people in those places where you're standing up to speak for us whom you don't know are there. And you may be speaking up in your parish of whatever denomination, and there may be no gay or lesbian people there for all I know. But you can bet there's a parent sitting there with a gay son or a lesbian daughter who is scared to death to tell anybody else in that church that they have a gay son or a lesbian daughter. And so this ministry goes really even beyond the LGBT community. My guess also is that when you have had the courage to do that, that it has transformed you in some way. You may have paid a price, you may not have, but my guess is that it has brought you close to something really important. And you never know who you're going to be helping. On this and every other campus that I know of, there are perfectly happy, wonderful students who are great athletes, president of their class, captain of the debate team, and so on, and they kill themselves one night, and nobody can understand why. Nobody knows why it happened. They were just beloved. You can bet that at least a significant number of them had this one awful truth that they could tell no one. And all the captain of the debate teams in the world doesn't make up for this thing that they have been told is despicable. You never know whose life you may be saving when you stand up and defend one of us, or a person of color, or a woman, whatever the ism happens to be. And we can't do it without you. We have to reach a point in this nation and in our churches where we are just simply not willing to live with that kind of hatefulness anymore. And we can't reach that by ourselves. And so it is an enormous thing. And if you're studying for the ministry or you're in the ministry, you have no idea what it means for somebody to be standing. Where's the pulpit? There you go. Standing in that pulpit. That's pretty scary. That thing could fall on you. But to stand in a pulpit, and you may be preaching about the lepers and tax collectors and people who were discriminated against in Jesus' day and how he treated them, and then you start to list people in the current culture that are being discriminated against and treated poorly, you have no idea what it's like to be a gay or lesbian person sitting in the congregation and just hearing gay or lesbian mentioned in the laundry list. It's like, oh my God, they know I'm here. I actually count for something. You don't have to do much for us to feel supported. And we appreciate it.
This is Duke University Chapel.